careful with that. You know, you have to get the, you have to get to the finish line. Day.
But we got to keep the doctors and the hospitals paid too. So if they go overboard, that's where they'll end up. And a lot of times, they will move so we can get their spots on the parade route. Which is, you know, you got to think pragmatically here.
I like that. You got to strategizing.
Yeah.
One of our former presidents used to say strategery.
Strategery.
So you got your beautiful guitar here.
Oh, thank you.
So you're going to perform for us?
Sure. Let's what do you want to hear?
Whatever you want to play me.
Let's see. This is a song. I always say this song is about the greatest city in the entire world, that being New Orleans, Louisiana. The Texas sun beats down upon me like the devil's smile. I'd rather be anywhere else than here. Was it a blinding lack of subtlety or just a lack of style? Responding to the ways and means of fear. Take me back to New Orleans, man, drop me at my door. 'Cause I might love you, yeah, but I love me more. My fingernails are bent until there's nothing left but skin. I'd rather be anyone else right now. The light that shone within my eyes is slowly growing dim. She told me when, but never said how. Take me back to New Orleans and don't call me anymore. 'Cause I might love you, yeah, but I love me more. How can I make this unhappen? You cannot make this unhappen. Choose before your choices fade away. I could be home by tomorrow if I could beg, steal, or borrow. I said you're there, you might as well stay. Morning mist arises through another crack in the glass. The lack of sleep has made me numb. But sometimes when she sleeps, she'll turn and she'll whisper his name. That cake must taste great, but I'll pass when you offer me some. Take me back to New Orleans and drop me at my door. 'Cause I might love you, yeah, but I love me more. Take me back to New Orleans and don't call me anymore. 'Cause I might love you, yeah, I might love you, yeah, I might love you, yeah, but I love me more. I love me more. I love me more.
Yeah.
Thank you, Michael.
LeBlanc, live.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Beth. Thank you, Michael.
Live here at WWOZ in the studio on the Thursday of Deep Craw.
Deep Craw.
You know, when you. Hearing the lyrics of that song, it reminds me of an expression that is unattributed, but it says New Orleans is the only city that ever loved me back. And and when you travel around, you know, it's like you've traveled around in the country, mm-hmm. the world, and mm-hmm. it's like New Orleans is like one of the few cities to me that everything kind of falls into place, everything kind of makes sense.
Yep.
Where you live in, I lived in places like New York, and I lived on the West Coast as mm-hmm. well, and it just seems to me that a lot of people just don't get a couple of things. They don't get hospitality whatsoever.
No, they don't.
They don't understand what that is, because no. Everywhere else seems like everybody wants to network. and get passed out business cards. They don't know how to just talk to people without some sort of agenda.
Yeah, some sort of agenda.
And if you don't have an agenda, they get suspicious of you, which is completely mind-boggling to me.
Yeah. It's difficult to approach conversations sometimes in other cities because, you know, other places tend to be full of people who are waiting to say what they had to say on their mind. So there's not a lot of listening. So, you know, oddly enough, here in New Orleans, people, as crazy as we are, everybody, people pay attention.
Right.
They pay attention to what's going on because that's the only way this place could work.
Right.
You know?
Right. So. This is a vibe city.
It's very much a vibe area.
And you're constantly being taught lessons in civility and decorum here, one way or the other, the hard way or the easy way. So it's better to be on the easy way.
Better to do it the easy way, because if you don't do it the easy way, then the hard way will come. Then the harder way will come. Then the hardest way will come. So.
Well, one thing I want to talk about as a live performer, since the very, very beginning, your take with the audience and the way you respond to them and they respond to you is almost like cult frenzy, in a sense of to you, music can be very explosive, and the performance element of it is something that comes from every fiber of your being.
Yeah.
And I don't know where you got that from, because not all New Orleans performers are like that, but what made you decide to be that way when you perform?
It wasn't a conscious decision. It's just the way I am. But you know, the old story is that I was born deaf. I had some deformities in my ear canal that prevented me from hearing, and my lungs were underdeveloped when I was born. Ha, ha, ha. And they couldn't operate until I was about 3. And so what my folks did, because I wasn't, you know, I wasn't improving, I wasn't responding to anything. I was just this giant flesh lump, kind of like I am now. But it was, so they had the idea, why don't we put his head on stereo speakers? So they laid my head on stereo speakers and would crank music, and it was like, you know, opera or whatever they were listening to at the time. And the old story from the family is that I could actually sing before I could talk. So for me, music and performance has always been, you know, just as much a method of communication as talking or writing or anything like that. And I finally got an operation when I was about 3, and it opened up my ear canals because my lungs had developed enough. So I think there's that. And also I kind of, I tapped into something maybe unconsciously a long time ago where I just realized that, you know, if you like being the young kind of punk rocker, you know, there's a lot of energy there. But I realized, okay, at a certain point from a philosophical point of view, this is like a really fast car headed straight for a wall. What do I do past that, you know? I mean, because I'm not one of those people that was ever interested in dying young and leaving a good-looking corpse. I wanted to live as long as I could, and you know, now with family and everything like that, I want to live even longer.
Yes.
But how can I maintain the enthusiasm? And a lot of it is just tapping into the enthusiasm of life, tapping into, you know, the energy flow that's already there.
Right.
And just, you know, and having a certain mindset and correcting your mindset, you know, whenever, because we all have issues, we all have problems, we all have hard times and things like that. You know, it's just like, you know, the whole glass is either half full, half empty. You know, I've gotten into, you know, prayer and things like that, just to kind of keep the energy flow going. And I find the less I get in my own way, the more that everything kind of flows almost effortlessly.
I like that. Yeah. Yeah, one of the things I want to talk to you about as well is like when you came on in the scene in the 80s, it's before everything, before social media, before internet, before all these things. Where and back then, I guess you could call it progressive American music, had a really interesting sense of identity. And at one point when you guys were coming along, there was all these notions of regional music, and especially, I would say,
Athens, Georgia,
the scene with R.E.M. and all those great bands. And in a strange kind of way, Dash Rip Rock fit in with that sensibility, and also with this other element that was coming in, which is an appreciation of country and roots music that was coming out of L.A. and the West.
And the appreciation of, like, Cajun music and Cajun culture in Louisiana, as well as, like, New Orleans culture here. You know?
Right, right.
You know, when I grew up, it was, you know, I thought that people like Lee Dorsey and Gene Knight and, you know, all the Meters, I thought they were as big as the Beatles and everything like that, because it was played everywhere here. It was kind of a mind-blowing event when I realized that other people hadn't heard of, like, you know, Ernie Cato, right. and, you know, things like that.
Things that we get spoiled on here.
Yeah, things that we get spoiled on, but also you just, it has such a permeative influence on the culture and the population, you know, both musically, obviously, but also personally, personality-wise, things like that. You know, it's very eye-opening to understand that the rest of the world doesn't move to the same groove that we do here. Yeah.
Can we get you to play one more live
song? Yeah. I can play as long as you want, Mike.
I love it.
What do you want to hear?
Man, whatever's in your mindset today.
Oh, I've got tons of songs in my mindset. Let's see. I'll go for the old familiar. A little song about a girl from Kenner. Oops, I messed that up. Try it again. I got no reason for the things I've figured, the things that plague me when I see and hear. A dime's a nickel and a nickel's none. I throw myself into the Sunday sun. A summer Sunday when you went insane. You said you're going, but I said I came. Throwing oranges in an apple cart. The ties that bind are tearing me apart. Jenny says, turn off the radio. Jenny says, turn off the lights. Jenny says, turn off the video. You beat yourself up. You bring yourself down. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Let it go, let it go, let it go. When the world is coming down on me, I let it go. I got no reason for the things I say. She turned toward me, then she turned away. There's lots of forces in a modern world that take their toll upon a modern girl. I got no reason for the things I fear, the things that plague me when I see it. Press my finger on an itchy trigger. What once was small right now is so much bigger. Jenny says, turn off the radio. Jenny says, turn off the lights. Or Jenny says, turn off the video. You beat yourself up, you bring yourself down. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Oh, when the world is coming down on me, I'll let it go. I got no reason for the things I do. The dealer deals and then the dealer's screwed. You throw your cards upon a playing table. My name is Kane and I am now unable. I got no reason for the things I feel. The things that plague me when I see and hear. A dime is a nickel, a nickel is none. I'm gonna throw my hairy ass to the Sunday sun. Jenny says, turn off the radio. Turn off the lights. Or Jenny says, turn off the video. You beat yourself up because you love it. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Or when the world is coming down on me, I let it go. Yeah, let it go, let it go, let it go. Let it go. Oh, 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 oh. Or when the world is coming down on me, I let it go. I'm gonna let it go. I'm gonna let it go. Yeah. Ow! Thank you, Michael. Thank you, man.
Fred LeBlanc right here live at WWOZ. Thursday of Deep Graw here in New Orleans.
Deep Graw.
Deep Graw.
Deep Graw. Deep Graw. Here's the theme for Deep Graw. Ready?
Yeah, sure. Deep Graw.
Deep Graw.
Well, Fred, thank you so much for coming on by and performing.
My pleasure, man. Thank you, Mike. Let's do it again sometime. What do you say?
I would love to do that again sometimes. Great. Do it even longer.
Keep playing the Jerry Lee. Keep playing the Jerry Lee. You need to find that album, Live in Hamburg, 1964.
Absolutely.
He plays with a pickup band that he never practiced with and never played again. It's one of the great rock and roll albums of all time. Trust me on this.
There's something about pickup bands. I saw... you know, one of the best pickup bands I ever saw was when Bo Diddley came to New Orleans, played at Tipitina's, an all-local band, and including J.D. Hill,
Cool.
Deacon John's band, and it was just outrageous.
You know, one of the first probably the first big gig Cowboy Mouth ever had. We had this booking agency out of North Carolina, some friends of friends kind of thing. They got us a gig in Charlotte. This is like 3 or 4 months after the band formed, where we not only opened for, but we were the backing band to Bo Diddley. And it was, he's like one of my musical heroes, you know. I've met all kinds of rock stars, you know, I could care less, but, you know, like Bo Diddley's just like, oh my God, it's Bo Diddley. And, you know, so, and he was only supposed to play 1 hour. He had so much fun, he ended up playing 2 hours. It was great. It was a lot of fun.
Well, he's one of those guys that, you know, the blues, mojo legacy of their lyrics. When you try to pick apart a song like Who Do You Love, you're like,
who comes up with that?
How do you come up with
but
that?
But not only was he a great guitar player, he was also an incredible singer, literally till the day he died.
Yeah.
He was just a great, great singer. And it's so funny because we were... After the show, backstage, you know, because a lot of the old rhythm and blues guys, they just got in the habit of bringing their skillets with them, and he's frying up some chicken backstage, right? And we were just sitting there talking, and he was like, hey, and I went up to him, hey, Mr. Diddley, you know, what do you call him? And, hey, Mr. Diddley, you got any advice for a young musician starting out for the band? He goes, well, boy, thought about it, he goes, well, keep it simple and think of church. I said, keep it simple and think of church. He said, yeah, that's all you need. And you know what? He was exactly right.
I love it.
That's great.
Well, look, we're going to close out with something that is one of my favorites. You know, sometimes when you're playing carnival music, you kind of just have to go to the next level.
Yep.
And, you know, one thing about you is that you have no problem being audacious.
Life's too short for niceties.
Right. So
I'm not a doily kind of guy.
I play this song and I feel like, you know, it's like, it's just, it takes Mardi Gras music to the next level. This is your version, Cowboy Mouth's version of Carnival Time.
So I want you to, oh, this is fun. Yeah.
This is
really
great. Fun. This is really fun. So anything you want to say about this? I have this, what inspired you to cover it?
I asked John Thomas to play the solo. I said, John, you know, why don't you play a solo here? And he's played the solo. If you listen closely, you can tell it's the solo for,
Johnny Cash song.
Johnny
right?
Cash, Folsom Prison Blues.
Exactly right.
Which is what he used to play with. He used to play in Red Rockers. So he just played the solo for Folsom Prison Blues, and I thought, wow, that takes balls.
That's genius.
That's
right.
Great.
And it kind of also goes back to the Jody Levin's versions. You know, the rockabilly version that a lot of people don't even know is part of that style of Mardi Gras music. There's more than one version of Mardi Gras. Like there's so many interpretations. So to bring that kind of a country element to it is definitely part of the lexicon as well. And y'all take it all and you put it all into the carnival time. I love it.
Well, you know the whole thing about Mardi Gras is that people forget it's actually a religious holiday, which is hilarious in and of itself. But you know the whole thing is just like. It's not meant to be one specific little thing. It's meant to be a whole pile of craziness.
Yeah,
you know, just as much as the celebration as the music should be. You know, so
absolutely. So again, thank you so much for stopping on by.
Thank you, Mike.
This is Fred LeBlanc and Cowboy Mouth doing their version of Carnival Time right here on WWOZ 90.7 FM.